morning, church.
Oh, good morning.
Thank you. Come on now. Okay, good morning, church. I was really disjointed here. That bothered me. Good morning, church.
Good morning.
I don't know why that bothered me. It's good to see you all today. We're going to talk a little bit about everything that's going on today. Another special Sunday. We've got a lot of them this month. We've got one more next month. Next week, as we have some special people being interviewed about their camp experiences. We continue with our focus on camping. So let's go to the big board. Who is an online viewer, we're glad that you're joining in the service today. Anyone who's here and wants to see parts of the service again, you can always go online. They're all there. We're going back quite a ways, you can look at it and catch up. As I said, April is Camp Awareness Month, and you can see our two interviewers right there at the very bottom there. Should be a lot of fun. What else have we got here? Parents and grandparents, there's been a group that's been meeting once a month here at the church to share their experiences with children and their grandchildren, helping to raise them. The next discussion will be next Sunday morning. Let's see the time.
9:30.
Wow, I don't even have to remember anything anymore. Oh, there it is. It's very tiny. Okay, next time. BBS. We have a vacation Bible school in the summer. It's in August. You see the dates are August 12th to 16th. Registration is open. So if you know any children or grandchildren or neighbor kids that would enjoy that, please get them registered. The theme is scuba.
Oh.
Yes. The reason some of you are here, I'd like to believe it was for me, but it's not. Today, very special celebration. We're having a potluck gathering after church in the gymnasium back here to honor and to thank Shirley for 47 years as our church secretary. So that'll be a lot of fun. And I know some of her family are here and that we're grateful for that too, for them to be here. What's next? That's it. Okay. Over here, one quickie. This container hasn't really gone up a whole lot in the last couple of years. Anyway, we're running out of time. We are going to wind up our coin collection next Sunday. That'll be it. And then we will organize a rolling party. I don't have a word for it. Get that all ready. There will be a contest where you can guess how much money's in there when we're done. And Carolyn's explaining this right now to Rick because he doesn't know. Because he's the one in the prize.
So they can, put their
guests
on.
Yeah. So, what's that, sir?
We're doing a thing so people can actually put their
guests
on.
Yeah, so we're going to get some sheets. It's going to be two. One for everybody under 12 and those who are over 12. See who can get the closest to the pack. So that'll be fun. And then we'll find out after that what the total is. Something I said?
No. You're okay so far.
Okay. I would like, if you can kill it for a second, the Lord, just when I'm giving prayer concerns, I don't like that they go on the internet. Let us begin our time there. I've almost forgot. I'm almost got that knocked over. Jim's going to teach us a new song. Sorry about that.
For those that are not normally here on Sundays, we like to introduce new music from time to time, and we find it better if we teach it to you before the service, so that when it happens in the service that there's more confidence singing. So, I'm going to teach you a song, I'll sing a line, and then you can repeat it back to me. This song is called Jesus, Strong and Kind.
Jesus said that if I thirst, I should come to Him.
No one else can satisfy.
Call your mercy and your grace. Our first scripture reading is from the book of Acts, in chapter 4, verses 5 to 12. The next day, their rulers, elders, and scribes, assembled in Jerusalem, with Annas the high priest, Caiaphas, John, and Alexander, and all who were of the high priestly family. When they had made the prisoners stand in their midst, they inquired, "By what power or by what name did you do this?" Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers of the people and elders, if we are questioned today because of a good deed done to someone who was sick, and are asked how this man has been healed, let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that this man is standing before you in good health by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead. This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders. It has become the cornerstone. There is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among mortals by which we must be saved."
Please join me for our responsive litany. Little children, let us love not in word of speech, but in deed and in truth.
All the Jesus' commandments I love, and God abides in them.
By this we shall know that we are of truth, for God knows everything.
All the Jesus' commandments abide in God, and God abides in them.
Beloved, if our hearts do not condemn us, we have confidence before God.
All the Jesus' commandments abide in God.
This is what God commands. Believe in the name of Christ Jesus and love one another.
And by this you know God abides in us, by the Spirit which God has given us.
God is the giver of eternal gladness, the fountain of life from which all blessings flow. All that we have is a gift of God's love. And so we have presented our gifts with thanksgiving. And as a grateful response to God's sacrifice for us, we offer our gifts and our lives in the full assurance that God will use them and us to spread the good news of repentance and the forgiveness of sins. Let us offer our gifts in prayer. We come, O God, as we often do, in absolute awe of the grace and the mercy and the peace and the love that you have showered down upon us. We thank you again for the opportunity and the privilege of participating in the work of your kingdom, both here in this community and beyond. And so, Father, we offer our gifts and we offer our lives to you. We pray that good things will happen to build your kingdom and to share your love and your name with all. Through Christ our Lord.
We're going to invite the children to come forward with their godly play helpers at this time, so come on up. Rocks in the story, and the burning sun, and weeds. Weeds. Not good for farmers when there's weeds, right? But before you do that, we're going to sing a song, and Darrell's going to talk to you. The song is from VBS a couple years ago, so I want big, strong voices. Let's give it a shot. Here we go.
Oh,
decided, looking at you, that you cannot grow any more big today. I think we, and look at the size of you, Carson. My goodness. And you, what is mom feeding you? I don't know. Well, I don't know. These two, mom. And yeah, sit down. They have big dreams. And somebody is going to be 4 years older this week. Yeah, Oscar's going to be 4. Anyway, that's okay. I have a problem. Yeah, I have a verse here that I don't think I understand. So I'm hoping you can help. You want to try? Sure. You think you want to try? Okay. Listen to this. This is from Matthew chapter 6, verses 19 to 21. Listen very carefully. Do not store up treasures on earth, where moth and rust consume and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasure in heaven, where neither moth nor rust consumes and where thieves do not break in and steal. That's interesting, eh? Maybe you can help me understand something. What is rust? What is that? What is that?
Brown.
It's brown? Well, I'm not wearing brown today. Oh, very good. It's metal that's laying outside in the weather, and things get rusty. Water damage. Actually, it's oxidization of the metal. That's a good word. Yeah, how many of you have seen rust? If you're alive, you've seen rust. Sometimes plumbing gets rusted. Yeah, it gets like that brown, whatever, at the end of that. But yeah, rust, and if you leave something out long enough and it gets too rusty, what happens to it?
It
falls apart. I don't know about burn fire, but it can... Okay, here's another one. What does it mean to break in and steal? What does that mean? Very good. That's really important, but they don't steal garbage. They steal things that are worth something, right? So money, diamonds, whatever. Yeah, okay, so we know what rust is, and we know what thieves break in. Here's one that you may not know, but we'll see. Where moth consumes. Ah, what in the world is that? You think you know. Ah, you're right. There are certain types of moths in this world that like to get in and eat wool, mostly wool. They get in there and they lay eggs on your coat, your sweaters, and what happens? What happens? It's what happens to your sweater. It gets holy, that's right, not holy. It gets holes. By the way, a little tidbit. This is why people put clothes in cedar chests or cedar drawers, because moths don't like the smell. And there's also a thing called mothballs. They smell really bad. So it says here in the Bible that we're not supposed to store up things that get stolen or eaten by rust or eaten by moths. So that would be expensive stuff, things that we enjoy. Okay, that's the next part. Okay, so we figure that out. What does it mean to store up yourselves treasures in heaven? That's harder to figure out. What does that mean? You're full of answers today.
Be nicer
to each other. Be kinder. Love each other. Love your enemies even. That's tougher. All the stuff that Jesus asked us to do, those are treasures that we put up in heaven. And when you store treasures in heaven, do the moths get to it? Do they get rusty?
No.
Does anybody steal it?
No.
There you go. So let's work together. You and I will store up some treasures in heaven. And they'll be sick. Okay. Let's pray together. Father God, we are grateful for words like these that Jesus gave us. Help us to store up treasures in heaven by being kind and caring and loving each other. In Jesus' name. Okay, well, the good luck.
Well, we've sung about moth matches up. Each part of God, and now we're going to look at a different side of how he is a gentle shepherd. shepherd to us. So please stand if you are able, and we'll sing together, Just the Shepherd.
Struggle with these kinds of questions or questions like them. I'm pretty sure that at some level they are the kind of questions that always kind of stick with us. And we don't just want someone else to say yes to those questions. We want to be able to say yes for ourselves. I think that's part of the reason that we are so busy. We're trying to show to the world around us, and maybe to ourselves especially, that our life does matter. That we do make a difference, and so we keep busy. It's often the unstated, maybe even the unknown reason why, especially when we are young and developing our careers, that we work so hard. We've got to prove ourselves. We've got to acquire. We've got to achieve, because we want to make sure that people know, and more importantly, that we know that our lives matter and we made a difference. And we've probably all had times when we look back at our lives, maybe when the kids move out, or maybe when we, I hate to say it, retire today, and we ask ourselves what we've done and whether we've made a difference in this world. I can't tell you how many times I've been to a retirement home or nursing home, and someone has said to me, "I'm just ready to go. I don't want to be here. I don't understand what God is doing. Why am I still here?" I can't help but wonder if what they're really asking is whether their life still matters. And what difference does it make to others whether they are there or not? Are they of any value? Regardless of when and how those questions come up, I think they are grounded in a deep longing and a great desire for the abundance of life. We want to be an abundant people. We want to live an abundant life. Today's gospel that I read for you begins at verse 11, but I want to go back and read the verse right before, because there Jesus says something very important. "I have come that they may have life and have it more abundantly." That verse, believe it or not, is right in the middle of what has been called the Good Shepherd Discourse of John's Gospel. Jesus' statement about bringing abundant life is kind of the hinge of these two parts of the chapter. Believe it or not, last year about Easter time, we looked at the first half of this chapter. Jesus' statement about bringing life was the conclusion to that first part. It was the ending point, if you like. Abundant life was the goal. Today, his statement means that abundant life is the beginning. It's his purpose statement, if you like. It underlines everything he will say today, and maybe to you the rest of your life. "I have come that you may have life and have it more abundantly." And that sets the tone for the telling of today's story about the good shepherd, the hired hand, the sheep, and the wolf. And so I want us to look at those four images in relationship to abundance. Where do you experience abundance in your life, and what does it look like? What does abundance mean for you? What does it feel like when you live apart or are distant from abundance? And I'm not talking about abundance in terms of quantity. Let's get that right out in front. This is not about quantity. Abundance is about the quality of life. It's a way of being. Now, all of us can tell stories of a time in our lives where there was something we wanted, and we worked very hard for it, and we waited a long time, and when we finally got that thing that we wanted, and once we had it, it didn't do what we thought it was going to do for us, at least emotionally. It didn't fill us up. It didn't fulfill our lives. It didn't satisfy. We got what we we wanted, but we didn't have any abundance. Abundance is that quality of life that lets us touch the deepest parts of ourselves. It connects us with the divine, with the holy, and with what's good and true and beautiful in this world. It's not so much about getting something we don't have, that's important, but living more fully into what is already present in our lives. So that abundance is love that leads to love. It's joy that leads to joy. It's peace that leads to peace. It's kindness that leads to kindness. It's stepping more deeply and more fully into our own life and into the lives of others. It never, ever adds pain to this world. Abundance is Jesus' way of being in this world. It's what he demonstrated. It is the presence of God lived through your life and my life. So what if we took in these four images in today's gospel, the good shepherd, the sheep, the hired hand, and the wolf, and considered them as kind of like a lens through which we can see abundance. They are windows into the abundant life. Now, when you hear about the good shepherd, who do you think of? Jesus, right? And that's the usual answer, and it's the correct answer. And I'm not here to dispute that it is Jesus, but I'm wondering if it could be more than just Jesus. Could you and I be good shepherds? Could I be a good shepherd to someone? And so I wonder, who has been a good shepherd in your life? I don't ask those questions to take away from Jesus, not at all, but to expand, to enlarge, to extend his presence beyond what we thought possible. Just think about Psalm 23, that famous psalm about the shepherd. What does the shepherd do? The shepherd leads, guides. The shepherd revives. The shepherd protects. The shepherd as a companion. The shepherd nourishes and feeds. The shepherd sets a table of welcome and hospitality in the most difficult places of life. When have you experienced that in your life? Have you ever had someone who's guided you in life? Have you someone ever set a table for you and welcomed you in the midst of terrifying and troubling times? Who has fed and nourished your soul? Have you ever had someone be your companion and walk with you through the valley of the shadow of death? Were they not good shepherds to you? Have you ever had someone say or do just the right thing and he or she has revived your soul when you just couldn't do it for yourself? Or how about those times you did those things for someone else? It was you that set the table. It was you who was the guide. It was you who was the companion. It was you who was the reviver. You were the good shepherd. I think this is happening in all sorts of ways. It happens when we're a parent, certainly. It happens when we love our spouse. It happens when we care for a sick or a dying friend, parent, or spouse. It happens when someone shows up and says to us, "Can I talk to you about my life? I want to tell you what's going on." And they ask us to be their shepherd. It happens when we go to another and say, "You know, let me tell you what happened to me. I can't make sense of this." We ask him or her to be a shepherd for us. Here's the thing. The shepherd, regardless of who it is always leading to abundance. The shepherd is always leading to green pastures, to the still waters, to the table that is set, and to the cup that is overflowing. It is always about getting to that place of abundance. Always. But if not as if abundance wasn't already there, it was there. It's always been there. It's been right before us the whole time. But sometimes we need someone to just help us see it, experience it, point to it, to show us that we're already there, and remind us of what's really important. I'm betting every one of you has shepherded someone else, and that there have been times in your life when someone else has shepherded you. So what about the sheep? Who are the sheep typically thought of to be in the Scripture? And that's right, us. Jesus is the good shepherd. We are the sheep. He leads. We follow. That's how it's supposed to work. And that's right. There's nothing against that. But again, I want us to expand that image, to enlarge it, to make it like a window, as I said, a window in which we might see the abundance we have in life. So, what if the sheep are the things that really matter? The things that have ultimate value in this world? What if the sheep are the things entrusted to us and that we entrust to others? Think about sheep as your parent, your grandparent, your loving of others, your friendships, your marriage, your teaching, your hopes, your dreams, your losses, your sorrows, your fears. We've all got them. We've all entrusted those things into the hands and the life of another person. And we've also been entrusted with those things by someone else. Someone comes to you and says, you know, I'm really struggling in my marriage. Can I tell you what's going on? There are sheep looking for the shepherd's guidance. Or you go to someone and you say, I don't know what to do with my kid. I don't know how to get through this tough spot in my life. I need some courage. I need some hope. You are the sheep looking for a shepherd. There's something about sheep that's abundant. It's their vulnerability. It's their honesty. It's the way they hope. They are full and whole and life-giving. It's why they matter. Why we care for them. It's why we receive that entrustment of great respect and honor. Jesus contrasts the good shepherd then with the hired hand. The hired hand, he says, does not own the sheep, and therefore does not really care for the sheep at all. For the good shepherd, the sheep are the goal and the reason for everything that the shepherd does. The sheep are everything to that good shepherd. The hired hand, however, they're just a means to an end. The hired hand goes and punches the clock and shows up to receive his or her wages. When the shift's over, she is gone. He takes off. He's done for the day. If things get too difficult for the hired hand, too scary, too risky, too wealthy, the hired hand takes off and runs away. The hired hand lives by quantity, not abundance. And probably every one of you could tell a story about a hired hand in your life. Someone who, when you needed him or her the most, ran out and left you. Who have been the hired hands in your life? There is another side to that question that is equally, if not more, painful, though. It asks us to look at our own lives and the times when we have been the hired hand to someone else. Times when she or he needed us and we just ran out on them. Hired hands stay only as long as the wages are good, as long as they're getting something out of it. The hired hand either refuses to see or can't see the abundance that is already there. She or he trades abundance for gain, for wages, for wealth. Whatever. In what ways have you experienced the hired hand in your life? In what ways have you been the hired hand sometimes? hired hand. There's almost always a wolf. Wolves, Jesus says, snatch and scatter. Wolves devour life. They destroy abundance. They carry it off. And wolves come in all kinds of shapes and sizes in our world today. Sometimes it's the wolf of business. It's the wolf of achievement. It's the wolf of gaining approval, or the wolf of having to be right and in control. Sometimes it's the wolf of fear, a wolf of anger or resentment. Or maybe it's the wolf of failure, the wolf of despair, the wolf of brokenness. So what wolves are you dealing with in your life today? How have these wolves snatched and scattered the abundance or the abundance of someone else that you care about? In some ways, Jesus is taking these four images and using them to paint a picture of abundance in our lives. If we let them, if we look through these images, not just at them, these images all point to the abundant life that Jesus is bringing and he is offering to us. It's kind of easy to see the good shepherd and the sheep as images of abundance. I get that. They point to what is. But what about the hired hand and the wolf? Well, they might be a little more difficult to get a picture through, but they point to abundance, but in a different way. They point to what is not there. They remind us of what's been lost, what's been carried away from us. What's abandoned? It is not as if the abundance was never there or never to be regained again. It's just gotten lost. It's been scattered. It's been forgotten. What do you see when you look through these windows into your life? Where's the abundance? What matters about you and your life? How might these images help you to make a difference? To live the abundant life, what will you do with what you see through these windows I've just shown you? I can't tell you what to do. A couple of days ago, and it's happened many times in my life, someone has come up to me and said, I just want some answers. Give me some answers. And I've said, to their chagrin, I don't have answers. I have no answers for you, and I don't have them for me. I'm not offering these four images to you as answers, but simply as invitations to open your eyes and see what is. That's all Jesus is really doing with this story. He doesn't give any answers here either. He says, you've got a good shepherd. There's sheep, there's wolves, and there's hired hands all around. But he never really says what we're to do with that. It's almost as if he's saying, I want you to look at your life and begin to work it out. Make sense of it for yourself. There's not one right answer. There is only each of us working it out in our own lives. That becomes even more clear when we step back from today's gospel and see where it sits in the sequence of the stories of the Gospel of John. Sometimes it's helpful and it's quite insightful to look at where the gospel story falls in relationship to what comes before it and what comes after it. Immediately before this passage in the gospel, Jesus heals a man who was born blind at birth. He opens his eyes. There is new seeing. There is seeing. There is new vision. There is new insight. And then Jesus tells the Good Shepherd story right there. And after the Good Shepherd story, the next big thing is what? He raises Lazarus from the dead. Wow. You see what's happening here? Do you see the sequence? Restored sight. The Good Shepherd, new life. Jesus is saying that we've got to open our eyes. We've got to see. We've got to look at the image to step through them into the new life that he's bringing us. The abundant life he is offering us. So what are you going to do with these four images today? You've got to know that we are never just one of them. We're all of them. There are all parts of us, pieces of our lives, ways that we have been and experienced as we have. Every one of us can tell a story when we were the good shepherd. And we guided, and we protected, and we nourished. And we can tell a story how just 10 minutes later we were the hired hand and we ran out. We could talk about the sheep that matter and are so valuable, and we could tell stories about how the wolf came in and devoured and snatched and scattered. It would be easy to divide this gospel into good characters and bad characters. Don't do that. Let's just hear this story as information about our lives while making a judgment or without making a judgment or a conclusion. Simply as an opening to the abundant life. I have come, Jesus said, that they may have life and have it more abundantly. It's his starting point. It's his goal. Abundant life is Jesus' promise to each of us. Let us pray. The God of Abraham, Sarah, Isaac, Jacob, families, to all those who have been our ancestors in faith, it is by your grace, O God, that we've been made with them and part of your family. You call us your children, and so we are. You watch over our comings and goings, you nurture our growth with sustaining wisdom. You send your Spirit as a guide for our wanderings and give the promise of Christ's redeeming love to rescue us from our waywardness. We thank you for the innocence of children and for their trusting natures. Teach us that same love and trust as we look to you for aid. Their dependence leaves them vulnerable to those in whose care they are placed. May they remind us of the obedience of Christ to the one who sent him in the world. Help our children to teach us what it means to be dependent on another. And give us some measure of humility as we seek to be faithful. We thank you, O God, for curiosity that leads to learning, for the willingness to move beyond what is already known. Use the spirit of inquiry to push us from complacency and make us impatient to know more of the truth. By the gift of your Spirit, give us an insatiable longing to see your will accomplished. Guide us to the Scriptures in search of wisdom, and give us the discipline to pursue that quest. We thank you for trials that test our allegiance, and the brokenness within that is a prelude to new growth. So when we shy away from suffering, confront us with the courage of Jesus, who endured on our behalf. When we avoid sacrifice, chasten us with your judgment, and fill us anew with the zeal for your righteousness. You have called us your children, you've made us members of your household. Help us to grow as faithful brothers and sisters in response to your trust. We pray, O God, for those that we have mentioned and those that are on our hearts who are struggling with poor health today, or are grieving deeply the loss of someone who is near and dear to them. We pray, Father, for those struggling with all kinds of social issues in their lives, and pray for redemption in those things that enslave us and make life difficult. We do thank you today, Father, for our sister Shirley and all that she has done for us. Thank you for bringing her to us 47 years ago, helping her to guide this congregation forward in all that it was doing in this continuing to do. Bless our celebration right today. And may we take her example into our own lives and serve you wherever we may be and with whatever skills we have. Father, thank you so very much for the gift of your Son, Jesus, who willingly went to the cross to die for us, that we might live. Thank you for him, and it is to him that we give our lives, and we offer the prayer he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and glory, forever and ever. Amen. Instead, as you're able to sing our closing song, Jesus Christ, Jesus Christ.
I should come to you.
disciples of us. Now you send us into the world to make disciples of others. Go with us and be our guide, and the witness of our lives may confirm the testimony of our lives. And we thank you, O God, for the food that has been provided for this wonderful celebration of the work that Shirley has done on your behalf and on our behalf. May it be a time of great celebration. In Christ our Lord. Amen.